Hey y'all, welcome to a Mindless Morning Show special interview. Sit back and relax with your hosts, Nick and Josh.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Mindless Morning Show. Today we are here with a super special guest, Rocky Kramer. He is a legit rock star, up and coming. He's been doing a lot of big things. He's got a badass album out right now called Firestorm. We're going to talk to him about a lot. First off, Rocky, how are you doing, man?
Doing well. How are you guys?
We're doing great. Great now that you're here.
Yeah, we're like your little groupies now. We're like, yay!
Hell yeah.
So, are you going to flash your chest?
I mean, if you want me to.
We talk about a lot more than you would think. I got ink, if that helps.
Yeah.
You know what
yeah,
I mean?
There you go. Okay, there you go. It's not my face.
Not yet. I'll get. This is my family crest. If I cover that up with your face, that would be some hardcore dedication, man.
True.
My mom would kick my ass. So, Rocky, tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you start all of this amazingness?
Sure. First of all, I'm from Norway, so I didn't start here. I started in Europe. I'm from a town called Trondheim, and I'm sure you're all very aware of it. It is the third largest city in Norway, but it's still small compared to any large city here in the States. Are you guys in the States, by the way?
Yeah. Texas. And he's in Florida.
Oh yeah. Cool. And so that's where I started out. My family is very, you know, they love music. They did it for a living, and that's kind of how I got started. Was because my father was a first violinist in the Trondheim Symphony Orchestra, and he's playing violin. So that's how I ended up playing violin. Was because he wanted my bigger brother to play violin, and he was struggling with it a little bit. So I was looking at it, I was thinking, I can do this. You know, it's like that ego kicks in. It's like, okay, you know what? I can do this. I can figure it out.
Hell
so
yeah.
I picked it up, and it's really just like moving your finger up and down, kind of like that, kind of like an ambulance sound. And I did it, right away. So my father said, maybe you should play violin instead of my brother, and get out of here now. And because my mom, who unfortunately passed away when I was five, she was a piano teacher, and she was she was great with the piano, figured it would make sense that my brother would play piano, and it made a lot of sense. And he actually, when he started playing piano, that was his instrument. So we both sort of found our instrument that way early on. And then not too long after that, I discovered rock and roll. And then I was like, wait a second, this is a lot cooler. And it's like, I want to do that. And first I wanted to play drums. So my brother got a guitar, and he was playing guitar, and he was writing songs. And then I would make a drum set out of like ice cream boxes, and I would play with pens or pencils, and I would make it sounded horrible. I used like the bottom of a Pringles can. It's made out of metal. I made a cymbal out of it, and it actually sounded like a little cymbal.
Oh,
like sound like that's how that was my dedication.
That's
and
awesome.
Of course, when I got a little older, I wanted to start my own band, and I'd already been interested in the guitar. But I still wanted to be a drummer. And I asked some of my friends, like, do you guys want to start a band? And, we're at 11. And they're like, yeah, sure. Why not? And I said, so who wants to play drums? And everybody wanted to play drums. Everybody's like,
of course.
I want to play drums. And I didn't want to argue because I just wanted to be in the band. And I figured, maybe I can do the second coolest thing, which is the guitar, in my opinion, because nobody wants to play bass, right?
I mean, so, I don't know. Why not?
We laugh because we're all like, I get it. I mean,
you're both bass players. You can tell me.
I am so musically challenged. It's not even funny.
I play guitar, but I just play acoustic and I just kind of fuck around with it. I'm not like, sure. I'm nowhere near shredding level, but I have fun. But
like, you're at that point where you bought a guitar, you never changed the strings, but it is missing two of them.
No, I've changed the strings a few times, but
okay, I gotcha. I just say that. I'm not trying to make fun of you. I know some people that buy a guitar and they're like, they break a string and they're like, oh, it's broken. Like the guitar is broken. And it's like, I want my money back. Dang, bro.
Oh, that would be a hilarious prank to do, to go take it into like a guitar center. Be like, this thing fucking sucks. Like, suck.
Yeah, this is so awesome. But anyway, so back to starting my first band. And that's when I really, I'd already, you know, tried out the guitar and I really liked it, but I wasn't as passionate yet. But it was when I started my first band that I really fell in love with it, because I really loved just the sound of an amp, you know, just that distorted sound. I just, we had a music room at the school and we could borrow an electric guitar and an amp. And that was my first experience with it. And it was just, I just knew right then and there, okay, this is what I'm going to do. And it all made sense. And of course I was in Norway. I was, you know, I'm a kid. I'm 11 years old, but I want to be an American rock star. So that's kind of how it started, right? And it followed by a lot of bands. I played in a lot of bands. Usually, I would start them. I would usually write the songs. I was kind of like a band leader for most of them. Not because I wanted to be in charge. It was just I just had a vision. I wanted to play original music. I didn't want to play covers. And that was kind of important to me to contribute something new. It's like, if you're a painter, you don't want to paint the Mona Lisa. You want to do something that you did, right?
Exactly.
So that was important. So just from an early age, I knew that it had to be original music. And you know, the guys were cool with that. And we wrote, I wrote a lot of songs with whatever band it was. Like, sometimes it was a trio, sometimes we had there were four of us, and but that's kind of how we got started. And we would play for, you know, we would play clubs and so on. We were 13 and it was this really cool thing for us, playing you know, in front of a club, which now I appreciate it more, because if you try to play a club here, like in LA in particular, or in Hollywood, mm-hmm. and nobody knows who we are, there's not going to be anybody there. But in Norway, people, they just go to clubs to, I guess, maybe to get, you know, to drink a little bit, you know, have a good time and listen to music. And so we always played in front of a lot of people, and we always had a good time with it. So it was kind of like an early introduction to what it was like to be, you know, in a rock band, to be, you know, kind of like a rock, living the rock star dream, you know, from an early age. So I just kind of got really used to that mindset even back then. And it was very serious to me. I was very serious about it. And I think I was much more serious than everyone else.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, we have to do this the right way.
Yeah. You know? Well, I mean, shit, you do, because I don't know a lot about the ins and outs of the music industry, but I do know it is extremely competitive. And if you aren't serious, I mean, shit, man, I totally get that.
And clearly it was that drive that has brought you to where you are today and still continuing to climb. So I mean, that's awesome. Right. Definitely speaks to your ethics of work and your dedication. That's awesome.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's even from like that, even before when I was 15, I just knew, like, I'm going to go to the US, I'm going to find a way to meet people. And when I came here, I didn't know anybody. Like, I was not invited. I just went here with no contacts, no nothing, and just started from scratch. And when you think about it, there are a lot of people that grew up here that never got a record deal. And I got a record deal within 11 months.
Yeah. You know? So it's like, that's crazy.
You know, you I don't know how, you know what I mean? Sometimes things happen for a reason, I guess.
Yeah.
I do believe that. I think there is something that, you know, you feel like some things are just meant to be, and it always made sense to me because of that. It's like, I'm here doing this. This is why I'm here. This is why I exist.
Exactly. And, you know, it also helps, like, when you started so early and you were doing shows at, like, 13 and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That really fuels that fire, you know, because you're getting these little tastes of, you're like, I can fucking do this. It, like, it really, really kind of kicks it into gear, I bet, you know?
Absolutely, because I remember the first gig we played. Yeah, we were a trio, and we were called, I think, Dark Symphony. I think that was Dark Symphony. And we were nothing close to a symphony as in the traditional sense, but we played, and I remember afterwards, people that I'd never met before came up to me and said, "Man, you're a great guitar player." And it was just, I'd never experienced that before, this, like, the idea of strangers coming up to you, and it's like, wait, what? You know, because usually we play in front of the school, and in the school it's like, you know, your friends or teachers or whatever, and you know, people you know for the most part would be the ones you would get feedback from, whether they're your friends or not. But all of a sudden, it's like people you never met before are, you know, saying like, you know, like they want to, you know, compliment you. Like, they come up to you. It's like, what, you know? It was just a weird. It was really cool though, and that sort of. I think it did inspire me to keep going, because if you go on stage and people are just booing you, then maybe it's not for you. you know, that's a sign there.
That'd be rough.
So, which I can imagine, especially if you're a comedian. I feel very bad for comedians who have to do stand up, and if unless everybody laughs at your jokes, it just feels awkward and uncomfortable.
I mean, that's why they serve so much alcohol at those.
That's what I was gonna say.
Everybody's drunk.
You go up on stage and you're like, "Woo! All right, is everybody drunk tonight?" And everybody's like, "Yeah!" And you're like, "All right, oh, thank God, thank God." Because we've interviewed a couple of comedians, and they talk about it like that too sometimes.
I have to ask, what made it more of a desire for you to be a rock star in America more so than Norway? I feel like
I mean, as much as I love Norway, Norway's a great place to live. When you're in the arts, in the entertainment industry, it is a bit limited in many ways, because first of all, there's not much of it, and most of it happens in Oslo, which I wasn't in Oslo. And there is a kind of a certain type of artist that they will promote and that they will push. We were offered some, like my band was, we did get in touch with some of the people in the industry, and we ended up and this is kind of a weird story. We were a guy that produced our demo, who was an artist himself, or he still is, he sent a friend of his who was the manager for a big rock band in Norway called TNT. Mm-hmm. And so they sent him to see us, and somehow he didn't end up seeing us, and he ended up seeing the band that played like after us.
Oh,
I guess he came in late or something.
Oh, no.
And so he started dealing with them, and then we're like, wait a second, he was supposed to meet with us, and we're thinking, oh God. But then it turned out, like, it didn't really work out for them either. It's not like they didn't become a super band, but it was one of those things where you feel like, okay, this is not going to happen. It's not going to happen here. So I just wanted to have more opportunities here.
Right.
And coming from Norway, which is very cold, I decided, you know, it would be nice to be in a place where it's pretty nice weather almost all year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a nice, you know, you got palm trees everywhere, and you can go to the beach. Maybe not all year, but it is nice.
I mean, more often than not. Yeah.
More often than not.
Yeah.
So it's just, and it's also just, it's the reality of making your dreams come true. Sometimes it's better to go somewhere, be uncomfortable, but make your dreams come true, and instead of just sitting at home hoping for things to happen, because at some point you're going to realize that it didn't, and that no one's going to knock on your door and say, "Hey, do you want to be rich and famous?"
Yeah.
Get out of here.
We got the cameras. That was so easy.
Yeah. Yeah, we got this mobile recording studio. We're going to do a music video, you know, right outside your house. You know, like it doesn't happen that way. You know, you're not going to be famous from your living room, even though obviously nowadays people do a lot of things at home and they do sometimes get discovered on social media. But that means you do have to be on social media. And
that's
when
true.
Wanted to do this, Facebook and Instagram didn't really exist yet, or maybe it did exist, but it was like
MySpace.
That was exactly it. When I wanted to do this, it was MySpace, and MySpace was a very different animal than Instagram. Instagram is a very fascinating app, whatever I should call it, because it is it. A lot of people just, they're sucked into it and they watch it. They keep scrolling and scrolling and scrolling.
Yeah.
You're getting those, you know, 3 seconds of fame, which is different than before, because usually you would at least get 3 minutes of fame if your song played on the radio or if you got a music video on MTV. Now it's like you have to get people convinced that they want to pay more attention to you, and you only have 3 seconds to do it because they're just going to keep scrolling. Because there's always somebody else that they can look at.
Yeah.
So it's a different mentality. So that's definitely something that I'm trying to figure out where I should be, because I want to push my music, and my music is an album. It's an hour long concept album that I would prefer that you listen to from start to finish. But that's an hour of your life, and I mean, sure, you can you know, do laundry, you can wash, you know, the floors of your house with headphones on, you know. But I'm asking for a lot, but I'm asking for what I think is maybe more of an experience, right? You know, it's not an experience to look at something for 3 seconds.
Exactly.
So it's just it is, you know, times are changing, and of course, you know, there's TikTok and all the other stuff where
dancing
videos, and it's just it's fascinating, but it's not what I originally signed up for, if you get what I'm saying.
Basically, to get a quick market, you have to do a really awesome, like, 80s get up and make the Kramer dance. You got to make up your own dance, and like, you'll be a viral sensation.
I need the Kramer dance. Absolutely.
The Kramer dance. I like that. I like that mug too.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. We don't even have a Mindless Morning Show mug. God damn.
I know. We're slacking.
It's a morning show and you don't have a coffee mug. I mean, what's going on here?
I've got beer. We don't even try to, like, we're a morning show, but that's just when we release. We record these at night, so everybody knows. Everybody
spoiler.
Knows.
So is it true that you really are a rock star with no morals?
No morals. So the idea of those lyrics, first of all, I want to point out that for those of you who are not familiar with my music, a rock star is really about dreaming about being a rock star. And it is, maybe it makes more sense if you watch the video that we have with an animated little Rocky. It's a teenage version, animated Rocky, that dreams about being a rock star. So if you listen to the song without any context, you might think that I'm saying I'm a rock star, you know, like in a cocky way. And that's not the point.
Right.
But I thought, and it was the producer Kim Richards who said, you know, why don't you make it? Because it was originally just oh boy, like after I'm a rock star, oh boy, like each time boy, 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 oh boy, oh boy, oh boy.
Yeah.
Too much oh boy. So I said, well, why don't you make it less repetitive? So I thought, well, it could be descriptive. It could describe what a rock star is. Maybe not correctly, but what people, maybe, you know, it's those impressions of what people think of when you say rock star. Well, what do they? Well, they have no morals, right? It's like, people get upset, you know, like when Black Sabbath started out and they were called, you know, Satan worshipers and all kinds of things, right? And it's just, there's a lot of that sort of mentality. So I thought it would be funny if it was like, you know, I mean, some of the lines are okay, like, you know, in style or in leather, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
Like, that's not too bad. Like, I thought no morals was funny because that is kind of the impression that many people have because of all the, you know, the sex and the drugs and all the, trashing hotel rooms and throwing TVs out the window. It's definitely an expensive lifestyle, at least for the ones that made a tremendous amount of money. But it's also just, for many, it's just about the music, and I want to make sure that, you know, the music is what comes first.
For sure. I mean, it could have been worse. You could have been like a rock star, satanic, you know, like that'd have been like, wait, what?
Well, wait, yeah, I love Satan.
I really like Rockstar, but you did upload an 80s synth remix kind of vibe to it on YouTube. And that I kind of enjoyed that a little bit more than the original. I'm not going to lie. I really like that.
Good. I was really listening to, there's a band called Churches, and they're like synth pop. They're from Scotland, and I was really digging their music, and I was thinking, you know, like, and they're a new band, but they're using a lot of that sort of 80s mentality, a lot of synths and drum machines. And I was thinking Rockstar, which was always kind of an 80s type of song, I think it came out maybe a little bit more 70s. So I was thinking, what if I just went all 80s and just did the whole thing? So I was kind of thinking more Michael Jackson, more like a Bon Jovi type of a mentality, and just without really changing anything other than not using any guitars. So I want to see if I could just make it all synths. As a challenge.
Because, that's cool.
It came out very, very, very well.
Good. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I thought it was fun. It's a good experiment to take your own music, something you created and decided that this is how it's going to be, and then flip it upside down and see what else you can do with it. And I mean, I could probably do the whole album in different ways. And
sure,
I think that's it's a good exercise for any songwriter or I guess producer.
Well, because it can open your mind up to think of new sounds when you're creating new music. You know, you're making a whole new song, you can, now you've had this experience of doing these different sounds, and it can kind of help you like, I'm gonna add this and this, you know, like it'll kind of branch out a little bit. But so before I forget, because I wanted to ask this question too, what made you think of the name Firestorm for your album?
Like the very origin of the term was actually, there's a video game called Tiberian Sun, and there's an expansion pack called Firestorm. That's where I got the word. Keep in mind that English is my second language. So Firestorm was not a word in my vocabulary originally. So, but the meaning of it and the way I used it for this album was really, I mean, the album is about a teenager wanting to make his dreams come true. And when you're a teenager, you know, there's a lot of emotion, there's kind of a lot of anger built up, maybe because, you know, things can't happen the way you want them to, and things, you have to wait for certain things to happen. And there's just a lot of that anger that to me just sort of was a built up sort of fire in my head. So, there's a song called Attitude, which is definitely the heaviest song on the album. And it says, you know, there's a firestorm in my head. And it won't go away before I get away, and which was the idea of getting away, not so much physically from Norway, but just getting away from the mentality that I had, sort of feeling like I'm here and I can't go anywhere, which is not the case, obviously. But it's that prison you create in your mind. I just wanted to sort of get away from myself almost. So the firestorm is just that. That is what's clouding your judgment.
That's perfect. Yeah.
That's a very good analogy. I like it.
It really is. I really like that. It's a perfect name for that album, man. Like it really is. It fits very well with the story that you're telling, which leads me to how was it when you jumped off and you left Norway and you came to America? I can't imagine, because I've lived in Texas my entire life. I can't imagine like the feeling of making a transformation like that. How was it?
It was pretty wild. I came here, it was in September, and it was still very warm. It was much warmer. Like Norway, by the time you get to September, or like, I think it was like the 21st of September. And it was pretty chilly in Norway, and going here, and it was still summer, and it was still warm, was like, huh, like it was yeah. a weird feeling. That was like the very first, impression of it. And then I think one of our first days I was here, I went to an English school, and I remember we went to Hollywood, and we were like driving around on like one of those tourist buses, and they were taking us around Beverly Hills, and we went to Santa Monica and all these areas that I've been looking at on a computer screen.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden I'm here, and it's almost like magic in a way, which doesn't happen very often. You know, it's like, okay, I'm actually here. Like I'm looking at the Hollywood sign. It's right there. I'm taking pictures of it. It's amazing. I was determined from day one to try to make something happen. And I actually played some shows here, and all I could really do was like play with an acoustic guitar or something. And, you know, three people showed up, and it wasn't much of, so nothing really happened. And I basically felt like, oh, maybe this isn't going to happen. Maybe this isn't for me. This is, you know, in the first couple of months, right? I'm just thinking, oh my God, maybe it's just not going to happen for me. So I went home for Christmas. This was, you know, now we're in December.
How old were you around this time?
I was 21 when I first came here.
Okay. Okay.
So yeah. And now I'm a few years older now.
Yeah. Yeah. We mentioned this earlier, guys, before we got on air, but I'm a month older than Rocky here. But so if you know how old I am, you'll know how old he is.
Yeah. It's no big deal. It's not, I realized, you have one life, and this is it. So, you know,
yeah, exactly.
It doesn't matter. But, So after a few months, I wasn't really very inspired, but, when I moved here, I was living with a lady who was a retired tennis teacher, and it was like a host family. This is through the school. Like they have, like they give you a place to live.
Oh, that's
and
cool.
So when I, you know, we started talking, and she's saying, you know, why are you here? And I say, what do you mean? She says, you don't need to learn English. Why are you going to an English school? Like you don't need classes for that. And I said, well, I'm really here because I want to be in the music industry, and I want to see if I can meet people in the industry. And she actually called her friends, and one of them knew one of her friends knew a conductor in Palos Verdes who knew a guitar player named Mike Panera, who played with Alice Cooper and Iron Butterfly and Loose Image. So all of a sudden, like now I'm like, okay, now I'm meeting someone in the industry, someone who's been doing it since the 60s. You know, he's
hell yes.
Even though he's still working, you know, he's been in the industry for a long time. So I started working with him. We're working on demos. He starts introducing me to people, and I would say, like, so I meet with him. I come back from Norway. He sends me an email. I this is all getting confusing, but he sends me an email when I'm in Norway for Christmas, when I'm saying like, okay, I'm not sure if I'm really going to do this. And when I get that email, it really just, like, I just, like, wow. I was ready to go. Like, okay, this
going
is
back.
It. I'm going back now.
Yeah.
You know, forget this ice cream and the Christmas dinner. I'm going to leave. You know? Get on a plane right now. but it wasn't that dramatic. But
yeah.
So I came back in LA in January, and I met with Mike. Only a few days later, I told him, like, I'm in Norway, like, can we meet when I get back? And he said, sure. So
no, deal's off.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
and the funny thing was, like, when I first read his email, I read it as, because I'm so used to dealing with people that are like, they're influenced by other people. So I thought he was just saying like, oh, he likes Alice Cooper or he likes Iron Butterfly. I'm thinking like, oh, that's nice. But then I realized, wait a second, no, he was actually playing with Alice Cooper. He was on tour with him, was in the studio with him for, you know, multiple albums. Like, you know, he was actually like working with Alice, and Alice Cooper is like one of the greatest, you know, musicians of all time. I mean, the greatest songwriters. I mean, he's great in many ways. And so it was like the first time that I felt like somebody actually paid attention to me in that sense. So he introduced me to Kim Richards, who is the CEO of Allied Artists International. And Allied Artists has a film group and a music group, a record label. And that's how I got a record deal, was through Kim, who then also wanted to produce the album. And that's how it kind of, that's when it really started happening, because like we did, we had a little, like a signing party at the Rainbow Bar and Grill, the famous Rainbow Bar and Grill where Lemmy used to go almost every night, but doesn't anymore because he died. But yeah. Unfortunately, but
yeah. Hey, rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Absolutely. And that was like the first moment where I really felt like, okay, now I'm really a part of the industry. So now I have to really prove myself. So, you know, we had to, of course, put a band together. We had a lot of things we had to figure out. And it's just sort of, that's how it all started. And then we ended up recording the album at 17 Hertz, which is the old one-on-one where Metallica recorded the Black album and the Injustice for All album, you know, like,
nice.
So
man, it's just,
like, it was amazing. Like, everything worked out, you know,
around, like,
dreams were coming true.
Yeah. It's awesome.
And it's so cool because I actually, to give a little backstory on that. When I was about 16, I was completely obsessed with this documentary of Metallica recording at that studio.
Wow.
And it's this you know, hour and a half of them being in that studio, and then all of a sudden, okay, now you're gonna be there. It's like, you know,
holy shit. And
it's so weird when you, and now again talking about, you know, making your dreams come true and you know, turning it into reality, I'm now in that actual space, and it's almost like everything is turned upside down, because now you're seeing, okay, there's a hallway here. There's the big room here. There's a mixing room here.
Yeah.
All of a sudden you're just, oh my God, this is the place, you know?
Yeah.
It's not a set, you know, it's not a movie.
They're
it's
like
a real place.
And they're like, Rocky, are you okay? Like, I think I forgot how to hold the guitar. Like, give me a minute.
How do I tune this thing?
Yeah, no kidding.
Was it really nervous for you on that day, to where like it was hard to play or focus, or could you be able to contain yourself?
I was definitely prepared, mainly because we rehearsed for a long time. We rehearsed for many months, basically a year. It took us a while. Like, it's a progressive album. It's a concept album. So we spent a lot of time working things out. And so by the time we went in the studio, we were all very familiar with the music, but being there was definitely, it was an awesome feeling. And I definitely didn't want to screw up. And I don't think I screwed up like any, I didn't do anything majorly bad.
Right.
But it was more about being confident, I think, than being nervous, because it was just kind of like, this is a big moment. So I just have to enjoy it instead of trying to overthink it. It's very easy to be nervous about everything, but I at least I'm so used to performing that I guess it's just like when it's time for me to perform, I do it. I don't think about it too much.
That's
thinking
good.
Thinking that's maybe it'd be your worst enemy.
That's very true. And that's good too, especially whenever you play at like large venues and you're doing openings and you're in some seriously high pressure things. But if you could just focus and be like, fuck it, I got this. That's cool.
The fingers do the talking.
Yeah, there you go. So are you any good at skiing?
You know what? When I was a kid, I did actually, go skiing a lot, but cross country skiing. I don't know how familiar or how much you care about that stuff, but that is the big thing.
That's a workout.
In Norway is like you don't necessarily go down like the real downhill skiing, but it's not always flat, but it's you're using your body to going, and it is a good form of exercise. And when I was a kid, we actually competitive. Like we would have, there were all these time challenges and that they had with the like a local sports team or something. And that was a part of growing up was participating in that and getting trophies and I mean, the trophies were kind of everyone gets one type of thing.
Oh, but, yeah, of course.
But you always like when you're a kid, you're like, oh, a trophy. But you realize it's a participation trophy, like really. But they had like different levels, like depending on how well you did. If you were particularly fast, you would get like a bigger trophy. And if you were more in that kind of average zone, which was me, because I was never a big athlete, but I did like skiing. But I was more average in terms of skiing, but I did enjoy it. And we also did a lot of skating. And in school, we would go skating if the weather allowed it, because you have to do that. Well, you don't have to do it outside, but we always did it outside.
Yeah, yeah. Of course.
Yeah, I have a buddy in a game dev Discord that lives in Norway, so. Oh. I had asked ahead of time to get a little bit of some Norwegian questions because he's actually heard of you as well. So I guess it is a very small world over there. But one of the questions was yay or nay on brown cheese.
Oh wow! Well, first of all, I'm assuming neither of you have tasted brown cheese.
No. And somebody did mention it because I had brought it up, and they said the actual name of it. I can't remember. I think it started with an L, and he said it was good.
Okay.
But I'm not sure.
I'm trying to think of a way to describe it because I've had plenty of it. I haven't had it in a while because normally when my family gets cheese, we like to get like regular white cheese. And there's actually a particular white cheese that's called Gredost, and it Ooh. I don't know how to describe it, but it's an amazing type of cheese. But brown cheese is physically brown colored. I'm trying to figure out why it's brown. I think it might have something, maybe it's burnt butter or something that makes it brown. I would say it's almost like a, it might be wrong to say that it has almost like a caramel type of flavor to it, but it's not caramel in the like, it's not made out of caramel, but there may be some similarities in the flavoring. But I have no idea who decided to make brown cheese. Like yeah. Who said, let's make it brown.
Yeah. Do it.
What?
I mean, there's some weird cheeses in the world. There's cheeses live maggots and stuff that I don't know. It's weird.
Yeah. There's a lot of nasty type of cheeses, and I will say that brown cheese is actually, it's a good cheese, unlike a lot of really nasty type of kind of old fermented type of cheeses, like really nasty stuff. It's not like that at all. It is a good cheese. It's just it might be maybe sweeter than regular cheese. Like cheese is kind of more, well, I don't know. I was going to say cheesy, but
that works. That's funny. Yeah.
So
I've never heard of that, but
I might, I'm pretty sure I'm going to butcher these words, but for Christmas dinners, I hear it's split between either ribe or pinnekjøtt.
Oh, maybe. Okay. Sure.
How bad was my pronunciation on that?
I will tell you how to pronounce it. The first one is ribbe. Oh, so you have to say rib, like you're saying ribs.
Rib.
And then be, like babe.
Okay. Ribbe.
Okay, and you have to roll the R's,
Ribbe. That's a little bit too much, probably.
Yeah, I don't know.
Arriba. It's a totally different nationality there.
It's a very, 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 very different. Yeah. So ribba is maybe one of my favorite Christmas dinners. We tend to have all of them. There's also lutefisk. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but that is a fish that is essentially, it goes through this long process, and they manage to make it into something that is almost like jello, but with practically no flavor. But my dad loves it. A lot of people love it. It's a delicacy. But they love it. But ribba, on the other hand, is actually really good. I believe it is a pig made out of pig meat. I was gonna say
jello pig.
No, made some pig meat.
Yeah, pig is good.
It's not like ham. It is not like ham. It's more like it's almost like a. I'm trying to think of the English word that would be the most comparable, but it is good. It's good, and they serve it with the actual ribs. So it is like there's lots of meat on top, and there's like the thick ribs at the bottom.
Yes.
So it's very good. It's very meaty. Like there's a lot of meat. Norwegians love meat. And
I want to go there.
Yeah. You gotta check it out. It's very good. It's very good. And pinnishet. Which is how you say the other
Pinnish
one.
Pinnishet. Okay. Yeah, I definitely butchered that. Sorry.
Which, big time. If you essentially split it in half, the first word means stick or sticks, like sticks on a tree, and shut means meat.
So like a kebab.
So it's basically stick meat.
Yeah.
And I don't know why it's really called that, but it is. I believe it's lamb. But it almost, I actually think it has almost like a prime rib flavor to it. Almost. But it's very salty. And the way, I think it's called stick meat because when you take it off off the bone, they kind of come off in like little thin pieces. Ah. It's kind of like little sticks.
Nice. It's like string cheese, but with meat.
Yeah,
that's wonderful. Exactly.
Yeah,
I like that.
It's like it's like shredded beef, basically, good. But it is very good. That's one also something that I really like.
Order me some of that.
Yeah.
So a question I have, because like you said that English isn't your first language. Well, if you would have said like you grew up learning both languages at the same time, I would have believed you. So like, how hard was English for you to like nail down?
It's not easy because I essentially wanted to speak it well enough that nobody would really ask, you know, where are you from? Or
I mean, I wouldn't have if I didn't know.
And there's two people, there's two types of people that I come across. There's the people that say I have no accent, and then there's people that say he absolutely, absolutely has an accent. So I don't know what it is, what's different. But anyway, I'm fortunate enough that we had English in school since I was at least 7 or 8. Mm-hmm. I want to say 8. It was like around that time. And but that's not really enough to get you to the point where you're speaking it fluently. I had the benefit of obviously having a lot of American television, and we don't overdub things in Norwegian like they do in Germany or Spain. We just have subtitles, so I'm so trained with subtitles for everything. And what happens when you read everything with subtitles is that you're hearing it in the original language. So you're hearing, in most cases, you're hearing the joke. If you're watching The Simpsons, you're hearing the original joke the way it is intended. And if you don't understand it, you have the, I was going to say lyrics, but you have the subtitles to help you. And sometimes they don't help you because they change the joke to something that makes more sense
in
Norwegian or in Norwegian because... there are sometimes it's just a word in English rhymes with another word and it doesn't.
So you have to change
the joke. And then all of a sudden you're like, why are they talking about a Norwegian artist? You know, it's like, they wouldn't be doing that. You know, then you realize that they actually said, you know, Bon Jovi in the show. But in Norway, they're like talking about some Norwegian artist because they just, to make it more, you know.
That's cool that they do that. For Norwegian. You know, that's, I didn't know that they did that. That's cool that they kind of like tailor it a little bit to me.
Yeah, now I question all the documentaries I've watched with subtitles.
Right?
How many of them were actually different? That's crazy.
That's crazy.
The buddy of mine from Norway, he says that Trondheim has a big stereotype of where they keep the leather vests and mustaches. What is that about?
There is something called Trønderbart. And I will translate that. Trønder means someone that is from Trondheim or from that area. It the larger area, which would, I guess, could be considered a county, would be Trøndelag. So the Trønder is basically, yeah, someone from Trøndelag. And bart means a mustache. And I guess the mustache is, it's a very impressive one, usually. It's kind of, it's almost like a fashion statement, but maybe not for the cool kids, more for, you know.
I want a really big thing.
It can be like the big thing, kind of with like a really thick one, you know, but usually something that you would get noticed if you had something like that. What was the other thing you said? Leather vests?
The leather vests and the mustache, yeah.
Yeah. I'm not so sure about the other one. I guess that might be a thing too. Maybe I'm more aware of the mustache thing. That feels like that's a very... popular thing, like they have contests and stuff, you know, people.
Oh, that's
awesome. Together,
you know, it's like mustache fest, you know.
I wish I had something like beautiful like that. I wish one day.
You're working on it.
What do you think I'd get like placed there? Like maybe like last?
They got like those mustaches from like the 1910s where they're all like super like. Or even further, like the Civil War mustaches, you know.
Their hairs are older than me.
yeah, no kidding.
I never thought about that. How long would it take to grow something out this far?
That's a great question.
I imagine it would take quite a century.
Connor, look that up.
He's talking to really nobody, don't worry. that's the mindless for you. So I got to bring it back just a little bit because I am a huge fan of Yngwie Malmsteen, and I know that is like one of your top influences. And how did that come to be?
It was actually the real story behind it is... it's a strange one. It started out with my brother telling me, you know, you should check out some of these guitar players. And one of them was Yngwie Malmsteen. And he said, like, you'll really like him. You should really check him out. And he said it like a couple of times. And I just didn't really get to it. But one day I was with my friends and we were riding our bikes and we were going really fast. And I was making a left turn and I fell. And I broke my collarbone.
Oh shit!
And so I had to have my hand like in like this for a week, and which meant I could not play guitar for a whole week. This was when I had just like I was absolutely obsessed with the guitar, and so it couldn't be a worse time. And I figured if I can't play guitar, I'm gonna study it. Guitar, and the first thing that came to my mind was Yngwie Malmsteen. I'm gonna really check out, you know, who this guy is. And I remember hearing you know, like songs like Black Star and Far Beyond
Such
the Sun.
Such a good one.
And it was so perfect to me. Like I'd heard kind of that the idea of kind of bringing in the classical music into metal was something that I heard at least through Randy Rhoads and I guess Richie Blackmore from, you know, Deep Purple and those guys, which Richie was a big, was Yngwie's biggest influence, at least on the guitar side, and Hendrix maybe, but just hearing the, and especially since I, you know, my family with the going to symphony concerts and all that at an early age, hearing the organs and the harpsichords and the choirs with electric guitars and the double kick drums and everything. It was so cool. I just thought, this is perfect. This is exactly the type of music I want to listen to. And of course it definitely influenced me as a songwriter too, because I just thought that, like, this is next level. This is really taking it, not just saying, okay, we're going to do a little bit of Vivaldi on the guitar, but this is like really taking it to that extreme level. And it's such an iconic sound that it changed my life.
Yeah. He has a lot of passion playing too. He's very fun to watch just shred on that guitar.
Definitely. He's a great showman. I mean, I love when he's on stage and he kicks the guitar picks like it's a soccer ball, you know, it's like, you know, boom, out in the audience, you know.
So do you have your signature move yet?
I was trying to think of something I could do that would be as like something iconic that if someone else did it, they would say, oh no, that's what Rocky Kramer does, or, you know.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
But it's hard because everybody's done everything at this point. Like, it would have to be something really stupid, like, you know, bring a banana on stage and just like punch my face with it or something, you know, just some random thing. They're like, oh, it's the banana puncher.
Yeah. You know? I don't think anybody can top Ozzy biting a head off a bat. So
that goes to the extreme. I definitely wouldn't recommend that nowadays.
Definitely not.
Since that's not a popular thing.
Maybe our
band now.
Yeah, maybe I don't know. Take like one of these like baby sharks and just like throw it at somebody in the audience.
You like, always bring up your baby shark in the interviews.
Don't worry,
all the time.
Shark, now let me ask you this: is that a real baby shark?
Yeah, it's real. He's dead.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah. He's dead.
My goodness.
I would hope he's dead. He's been in that jar for years.
Yeah.
He's alive. Help me. Get me out.
You can make yourself puke on stage. Now, that's something. I'm sure that's been done, though.
Hey, but nobody wants to do that. That's Justin Bieber's move.
You just became my favorite rock star.
Oh, that's man. Awesome.
We're gonna tag him in this interview too, so it's gonna be great.
Oh, there you go.
Big old middle finger. So we'll take a quick break here, and we got tons of random little questions to ask you. So
sure,
we will be right back.
Can't you see he's the man? Let me hear you applaud. He's more than a man. He's a shiny golden god. If you think it's time to fucking rock and fucking roll out of control, well then you know you've got to run the block. You fucking sock, my fucking cock. Cause when you rule, you fucking school all of the fools out of their jewels. Cause if you think it's time to,
if you think it's time to,
if you think it's time to fucking rock, he is going to kick your fucking ass. And you know his name is
Rocky Kramer.
Hey, everybody, we're back. Rocky Kramer did not leave us, which is awesome. He's still here, and we are going to ask some mindless, stupid questions. Nothing too insane, just basic, innocent shit. And if he thinks of a story off the top of his head, it does not matter where the conversation takes us. We can go anywhere. Doesn't matter. So, first question is, do you, and if you do, what is your favorite dinosaur?
Ooh, that's an interesting one. Favorite dinosaur. I will definitely say that I'm very bad when it comes to the names of dinosaurs.
Sure.
So I am a little bit limited when it comes to actually being able to name them properly. But so I might just have to go with a simple T-Rex.
Okay.
Which I do find them very iconic in terms of their look, but they're not very practical because of the you know, the short hands. So I don't think it's the optimal one. There are a lot of weird dinosaurs. I do find dinosaurs interesting.
They are.
Like, you got the ones that, what's the ones with the very long neck?
You're thinking of a brachiosaurus, the ones that eat the tree leaves way
That one, yeah, the very tall one.
The stego is the one with all the plates on.
Stegosaurus has all the plates along its back.
That one looks scary. I think I had like a plastic toy of one of those.
Hell yeah.
It was like a very short
bunch of dinosaur toys.
I think every single 90s boy had dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Toy dinosaurs at some point, man.
Of course.
No matter where you were in the country. World. Yeah, see,
world.
We're smart for naming this the Mindless Morning Show because we say some stupid, wrong shit all the time. So this is great. My favorite, just so you guys know, is the Ankylosaurus because it's got that big ass like club tail, and it's the only like vegetarian dinosaur that the carnivores didn't fuck with because it had all the spikes on its back and it was like a big plated armor tank. Those things are badass.
So, I forgot about that one. That's a good one.
That can be your favorite too. We can be dino buddies.
I like it. I might take that one.
You can switch. It's cool, man. I'm totally cool with it. So if anybody asks,
dinosaurs. I'm gonna stick with the little raptor. I like little raptors.
Little raptor.
They're fast. They're agile.
That's true.
The little fast ones. Yeah,
that's true. My daughter, she went through a dinosaur phase. She's 9 now, but when she was like 6, she went through like a big dinosaur phase, dude. She was watching documentaries about dinosaurs and shit, and she knew more about the names and shit than all of us. So it was cute. It was so cute because we'd be at like the store and she'd have like a dinosaur shirt on and like, like somebody would be like, oh, that's a cute shirt. What's your favorite dinosaur? Literally, she's like, I like the Pachycephalosaurus. They're like, oh, that's cute. And they're like, I have no fucking idea what that is. And she's like, yeah, that's my favorite. I'm like, I love you, kid. That's amazing. Like, you're just like, yeah, so... our last episode, we talked with a friend of ours, Red, and he explained some weird ghost encounters that he had. Have you ever had a ghost encounter or know of anybody that did? I haven't. So if you haven't, it's okay. But
I will say that I've had more, and I think this is more, I was reading about dreams the other day, and it's sometimes you know your dream, you can dream about ghosts, but it feels like it's real. Mm-hmm. I've definitely had that experience where I feel like there's a presence in the room, but I never seen anything. But I've definitely had moments where I feel like, oh my God, is it for real? So particularly the house my dad grew up in, he actually inherited that house, and it's a really old house. It's probably, I think it's from the 1800s, like the late 1800s. It's just been very well kept. And I remember just like being sleeping in that house sometimes would be very creepy in a sense. Like I felt like there's something in the room with me a few times. But I never saw anything. So I can't, you know, It's all in your mind, really, but it's still kind of like, oh my God.
There's
trolls in Norway, man. That's their thing. That's one of my favorite parts of the Norwegian culture is all the trolls.
All the what?
The trolls.
All the trolls. Yeah, that's a very different thing. The trolls are definitely. That is. I don't know why Norwegians became so obsessed with the trolls, but I definitely grew up with that. They have a lot of. If you go to like a souvenir shop in Norway, there's a lot of these little trolls you can buy.
Oh wow!
And it. I always associate Norway with trolls, and I feel like unless you know what they are, because nowadays when we talk about trolls, you talk about the internet usually, but in Norway, like I associate them with these little cute little creatures.
Yeah.
Much more innocent.
Could you imagine if I asked you that ghost experience question and you're like, I'm haunted every day and you brought that up to me here. I'm out. I'm done. You'd be like, oh shit, yeah, yeah. This totally bails. Like Josh would be so mad at me. This is not so much of a random question, but do you recall or know of any like pranks on tour, or is it like, I don't know, is that something that y'all do when you're touring, is do like little pranks or whatever? Or
We're very, I would say we're very nice people.
That's good.
Luckily, I know that there are, I've heard a lot of prank stories, but sure. We haven't, I would say we haven't toured enough that we've gotten to that point where, like, so you know, when you were Metallica in the early 90s, you were touring like 3 years straight, and that's, yeah. it drives you crazy at some point.
I bet.
But we've been lucky enough that we go on tour and then we get to go home for a while, so we never get to that point where we're just completely exhausted of each other. So I would say there's nothing in particular that comes to my mind, but maybe I'll have to think about it for a second.
yeah, no worries.
That's good. You got a tight-knit little family with you.
I like that.
It's a lot better than having to look over your shoulder wondering what's going to happen.
Yeah, like Jackass, if you're familiar with that show.
Yes.
They're behind the scenes is, I would be terrified for my life. Like, they are constantly like kicking each other in the balls and like breaking their stuff. Or like, I just like rigging up these crazy contraptions. So if you walk into a door, like slaps you across the face with some rubber hand, like all these things they do. Like that's no,
could
that's
do too it.
Much. I liked. I'm a big Kiss fan, and one of my favorite stories from them on the road was apparently they thought it would be funny. I think it was Ace Frehley, the lead guitarist. I think it was his idea to. He bought a bunch of super glue and he glued all the furniture in the hotel room, but upside down. So you walk in and you're like,
oh my goodness.
That must have been a trip.
Yeah, that would freak me out. That's
incredible that super glue can hold up furniture to a ceiling.
That's a lot of thinking the same thing. Like, did they get the bed and everything? Because that's
impressive.
That's a lot of effort too, man. I mean, I'm impressed. That would be.
Yeah.
That's a good one. So being from Norway, do you like hockey, or did y'all ever watch it or play it, or is it big there?
It, you know, hockey is big, and what's weird is that the school I went to, like the elementary school that I went to, there wasn't much. We weren't really big on hockey, but the one that was the elementary school that was right on like next to us, or like the next neighborhood. Which we ended up going to high school together, or middle school actually, or junior high. I don't know which term I should use because we call it something else. But so when we joined together in middle school, all of a sudden there's all these hockey people, and we weren't.
Wow.
It was like we were like soccer is the biggest sport in Norway, which is weird because Norwegians are not very good at it. you know, it's like, but it is big. It's very popular. But in Norway, they had this one time when it was 98, and I'll probably be banned from Norway for not remembering the year. But they were playing against Brazil, which is always considered the best soccer team.
Oh yeah,
and they won against Brazil, and this is the biggest thing, biggest event in Norway. Like, people still talk about it. Remember when we beat Brazil? you know, it's like, okay, let's forget about that. I think Norway should focus more on hockey because it's a sport that is maybe more natural. I know Sweden is really big on hockey. So for some reason, Norway is more into soccer. But I do remember that there was like in middle school, there was a bunch of people that wanted to play hockey, and or they actually were playing on like a junior team. Mm-hmm. And none of us did. So it was us playing against them just in school would be rough. Because they were, you know, hockey is a violent sport.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's great. You know, so when you're just playing for fun.
It's crazy. Like that's brutal. Like that's like the only sport I could think of to where Like, if people start fighting, the refs are like, just let them go, and then we'll, yeah, like, yeah, cheer them on. Let's let them go. Like, we'll clean the blood up later, pick the teeth up later. Yeah. They'll spend five minutes. They'll spend 5 minutes in the penalty box, and then they can come play again.
It's only five if it's a major, but it's basically like gladiators on ice. It's amazing.
Yeah, it is. It's great. I love it.
I will say that I didn't play it very much, but I did play NHL 2001, the video game. I did play that a lot. That was like that was my jam for many years.
2001 was the best year because that's when the Avalanche won the Stanley Cup.
Josh plays. I play the hockey games. I can't recommend enough. If you do play games, definitely. Yeah. They're really fun now. The new ones, they're crazy fun.
I just started kind of getting back into NHL 19.
Oh, okay.
So because I started on PC. Like, I played back in the day. I was playing it on PC. So now I haven't played any NHL in a long time. So now I'm trying to figure out how to play it with a controller. So it's like,
are you different. On PlayStation or Xbox?
Both. But I've been playing. I also have NHL 18 on PlayStation, but I have 19 on Xbox.
Okay.
Nice. Oh, yeah. I think I have from like 16 to 20 on PlayStation. So let me know.
Hell yeah.
That'd be fun.
There you go.
I love the new hockey games because they got that ragdoll physics, man. You hit somebody and they go freaking flying. I love that. I'm so violent.
It's fun because like there's a part of those games is the fighting. And I always thought that was funny. When I played like back in the day, it was like, I triggered one of the fights. It's like, and then you're beat the other guy. No, punch, punch, punch.
And it's almost now it's definitely a separate game mechanic because like you're playing the hockey game and then a fight starts out and it brings up all these new controls and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, shit. Oh, this is a whole different game now.
It's a little mini awesome, game.
Man. It's great.
it is really cool, man. So next mindless question is, do you like roller coasters?
Roller coasters.
I ask because Josh does not.
Yeah, I'm terrified of him.
Yeah. He does not. If I'm going to show you what I look like when I ride a roller coaster, it's kind of like this.
Dang! So you're just like, fuck it.
It doesn't scare me, but it doesn't entertain me either.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's not really for me. I guess I'm not that big on those things. I've never been to Six Flags though. Maybe I would like that.
Come on down, brother.
I need something that is a little bit more. From what I can understand, Six Flags is more focused on roller coasters that are a little bit more exciting and
they're crazy.
Yeah, something that it will make you feel something.
they're crazy here, so
I can walk through the line of like a kid's coaster and like my heart's already pumping, like I don't want to do this.
You're like,
I hate roller coasters. I'll be like a screaming kid. Like somebody will look back, think they're about to see a chick, and it's just me like panicking.
Oh, that actually reminds me of a quick little story I have of the most terrifying moment I've ever had at an amusement park. I know this is about Rocky, but if you don't mind, it's a pretty good story.
Go ahead.
Okay. So you know those rides that they take you up really fucking high and then they just free fall you, drop, right? Okay.
The
first time I did one of those, loved it. Thought it was so cool. I wanted to go back on again. We were there for like a middle school field trip because we read like a shitload of books or something as a class. So they let us go to fucking Fiesta, Texas. So we went on again and it launches us all the way up and I'm holding on to my belt, my plastic thing. And I said, hey, wouldn't it be crazy if I push this and it unlocked and I push it and it fucking unlocked? And dude, I have never been that scared before, ever. It it unlocked, but it didn't, like, the rope belt didn't come undone, but it was, I can't even, like, talk about
you were
it.
Loose.
I shoved that thing down and I, like, embraced it. Like, oh my God. I, like, was hugging that plastic cover.
For dear life.
And I guess when I brought it back down, it locked in better or all the way. I don't know. Because when it went down, I was fine. And then it went up again. I'm like, this is the whole time. My friend next to me was like, stop the ride. But nobody could hear you. And then I got off and I'm like, never again. Never again am I going on that ride.
That'd be enough for me.
Wow. I will have to say that I've read about roller coasters being introduced and then the first, like, official ride, and it's just like it comes off and people die. All I'm thinking is, I would never want to be the first one. I'll be like number, you know, ride number 75, you know, maybe I'll be the one, but I would never do anything that goes upside down. I would never do anything like that. Like, it has to be, it can go fast, but I don't want to be upside down.
Oh, and that's even right now.
Like, yeah, the one, no, I'm saying, like, if I had
to, as a first,
I had to be on a roller coaster, well, really any roller coaster, I would never do anything that would risk my life.
Yeah, no kidding. I think now they have to do like over 100 runs empty and then like a bunch with weights in them or something to like simulate people. And
yeah, they put dummies in them.
Yeah. That's crazy, man.
It's fun to watch the dummies. What's that?
Are they American sized?
Oh yeah. No, they have those super obese ones in there that take up like both the seats. So you had mentioned that you watched a lot of American cartoons or American television in general. Did you watch any cartoons at all?
A lot.
Like the 90s cartoons, like Hey Arnold and shit like that.
I basically, you know, I grew up with a lot of the, you know, Cartoon Network, and we had a channel called Fox Kids, and it is not related to anything with Fox really, but I guess it kind of originated from that. And I know that there's no Fox Kids channel here as far as I can understand, but it was all cartoons. And I think it later was replaced with Disney, the Disney Channel. Okay. But it had just all the, like, what's the one? Johnny Tsunami? Johnny Bravo.
No, Johnny Bravo. Man.
Johnny Bravo.
The cartoon womanizer.
what a character. I'm trying to think of the other ones. What's the one that's called? Ed, Eddie.
A lot of
those type of things. And of course, I'm a big Simpsons fan. I think I did mention them earlier. Simpsons and related stuff to Simpsons, you know, Futurama, all that stuff, I think is very well done and iconic. I watched a lot of Tom and Jerry. I think that was my favorite growing up. And
Oh my God, look at that. Look at that.
I
can make that bigger.
Every single episode.
There we go. Nice.
Yeah. Every single episode, Josh shows off some sort of tag, but it's always related to like what we're talking about. I don't know how he does it. He's like a weird billboard.
Yep.
All he does, it goes in the back and he gets like a Sharpie.
Yeah.
What am I going to talk about today?
What?
He did tattoo all those himself though. So that's impressive enough.
Oh really? For real?
Yeah.
Really? That's
does himself. Yeah.
Isn't that very?
That's why it looks really bad. Like, it's not like the cleanest lines or anything.
It looks good here. Are you? Do you like art? Do you like doing things like that?
Yeah.
Like, do you do the artwork and stuff? Do the physical?
Does all of the graphic designs for Mindless Morning Show, because we've got works.
Physically though, I do like painting on canvas more so than anything.
Uh-huh. That's nice.
As far as like drawing, I draw a little bit. I just prefer to paint or spray paint.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. I like that.
Good stuff.
Yeah, let me know, man. If you need an album cover, I got you.
I, I would like, yeah. I always like knowing who to contact for those type of things, because always need graphics for stuff.
We're always available. We don't have very big lives. So we're always around. That's the good thing about us.
We're just rock star dads. That's it. We got one. I got one little fan. He's got three little fans. That's it.
Yeah.
It's exciting. That's for sure. So I was going to ask it. Do you have, I know you had said that you guys haven't done a whole ton of touring, but do you have any like crazy story about a fan or about a rock star moment or anything that you can think of at the top of your head?
How many bras have hit the stage?
How many bras? All of them.
All of them, of course. All of them.
Yeah.
Just, yeah. it's always when you're on stage, that always sort of it attracts, you know, people for sure, definitely.
That was very high class of me. I know.
That was very it makes me think. I remember when I was I guess a teenager, we would watch the Ozzy Osbourne it was the Black Sabbath doing the song Dirty Women, and just every 10 seconds, even on the DVD, they would be like, "Woo!"
Oh wow.
And we're like, "Wait, what?" it's like, this is, I didn't know this was happening at these shows.
Okay, I am in the right line of work.
You know, this is inspiring.
Yeah, no kidding.
I think we've been lucky that we haven't had like the very bad stuff. I mean, there's always crazy things that happen, but it's we managed to make sure that people are at least safe and nothing crazy happens. You know,
no wall of death at your shows.
No, yeah, there's a lot of, you know, people that, you know, they might want to marry you or you know, whatever. It's like, what's your name?
Marry me, touch my hand. Oh yeah. That's a good one.
Yeah, there's
awesome.
I mean,
you can go down there.
It is cool when people want to get to know you and everything, but
yeah.
Sometimes they're a few steps ahead of you, you know. So
it's awesome, man. Do you ever listen to like hardcore death metal, like anything super crazy?
I definitely have. I've explored all kinds of metal. I mean, all kinds of music, really. But
sure,
I would say, I mean, when I was a teenager, I remember listening to Children of Bodom.
Bodom,
They're I thought they were pretty awesome. But they just lost their guitar player, which is
really?
Yeah, I forget his name.
Alexi Leaho or what?
Alexi, yeah.
What? That's news to me.
He had cancer, I think. I might have this wrong, but he did pass away. I think it was a few weeks ago. Like, it was.
Holy
very crap. Unexpected. I didn't expect that. They were a very, very interesting band. That's probably, I'm usually not very big on that type of vocal because I find it a little bit exhausting. But sometimes when if you're a little maybe angry or you just want to get some aggression out, that's the type of music that maybe reflects your emotions the most. So it helps.
It helps
that release.
I listen to it a lot at my day job.
Are you a mailman?
I gotta fight the dogs off, man. I gotta fight the dogs off. Josh is gonna laugh because I mention it almost every single time we do an interview, but I'm a new construction and remodel plumber. So
I'm
in houses pretty much by myself, like ripping stuff out to put in a new shed and like doing all this stuff and beating stuff with a hammer. So I always blast metal, you know, but
That's cool.
I was playing Firestorm though, cause I knew we were going to have an interview and I wanted to listen to it, you know, get into it and stuff. And I do like that. I do like your type of music as well. I'm not just a metalhead. So there is that.
Very cool. I like it.
Yeah, I like the hip thrust you got going on when you're playing the guitar in the music video, because that's basically like my dance move I got going on while I listen to it.
Yeah, shit, yeah, man. It's a good move to have, honestly.
So what is your favorite, like, of all time band?
Aside from Rocky Kramer.
Aside from Rocky Kramer, yeah. I would never say myself, even though I like to.
Right.
I like to create... I always like to think myself as I want to create that artist that I want to see, that I want to hear. Obviously, everything that I listen to is influenced by that. And I would say one of the bands that really blew me away when I first heard them, or at least when I first heard some of their songs, was Pink Floyd. Just because it's so much of an experience. It's not just music. A lot of music is just... kind of, it's just music, but Pink Floyd is more than that. It's an experience, and some of their songs just really, just you zone out, you know, when you're listening to it. And that's maybe one of the most important things with music, is something that really makes you feel something. And
yeah,
so that they're big. I mean, I'm you know, my first rock band was Kiss, and I love Kiss to this day, and I know that. To some, Kiss is a bunch of guys wearing makeup with no talent. But I see much more than that. I think that they're great songwriters. I think they're great musicians. They make, you know, some mistakes here and there, but who doesn't?
Yeah,
And they put on a hell of a show. It's very entertaining, and it's very iconic. And I think they really deserve all the success that they've had. And it will be sad that it will be sad when they've finish their tour, because they are doing their final tour now.
Yeah.
Which they technically, their farewell tour was the year 2000, but we won't talk about that.
Yeah.
now it's for real. Now I think it is time for at least Gene and Paul to call it quits. But I think that the idea of Kiss as something that could be, you know, you could replace all the band members whenever you want and just keep it going. I think that is actually something that they could do, because it's different than a lot of the other bands, because they're wearing the makeup. It's more of a persona that,
right.
You know, I think they can be replaced. I don't know about the music. If Gene and Paul were not involved with the album, it might not be Kiss anymore. But yeah. I think that there is a certain mentality that Kiss has developed that can live on forever, even without Gene and Paul. So
yeah,
we'll see. Other bands that I would want to mention, I was a huge AC/DC fan. I had bought every CD when I was 12. I love them very much, even though, I mean, a lot of it is the same. It is kind of, they developed a formula and they never changed. It's never changed it. You know, it's not like Coca-Cola coming out with new Coke.
Right.
And exactly. Everybody hating it.
Yeah.
It's just like, here's the classic Coke, and you're going to, this is what you're going to drink, and you're going to love it. And I like that in many cases, because when I write music, I write so many different types of genres. If I sent you all of my demos that I have just as of today, there's hundreds of songs and all different types of not only different types of metal and rock, but there's pop and there's more electronic music. There's all kinds of stuff. And like, I can't make up my mind, you know, like I'm always doing different things. It's nice to see that somebody just, you know, like AC/DC, they just, we have two guitars, bass, drums and vocals.
Yep.
No keyboards, no synths or strings. They never had a piano or synths or anything on their stuff, and they don't need it.
They got away with being able to do that. I mean, I know, but also, like you said, you know what you're getting into with them, and a lot of people do like that, because God, I mean, I'm sure you know, so many bands get ripped to shreds when they change the sound, like
Metallica.
People are like, that sucks, you know, I was a lifelong fan, fuck you guys. And it's like, geez, man.
Everyone got mad at Metallica for the recent one, and I gotta be honest, I liked it regardless, because it's still Metallica. But like the old school fans, I grew up on them, went to their concerts all the time, they hated it.
Metallica to me, I
I mean, I love Metallica. I mean, it may not be the band that I listen to the most, but I think that their early stuff is important. I mean, the Cliff Burton stuff, but what they did after, I mean, there's a lot of, I enjoyed all the different eras. I mean, even Saint Anger, which is maybe their most controversial album. I still think that the music is good, even though I still hate the snare, but you know, that medley snare, or bell-like snare, whatever you want to call it, was maybe not a good choice, but just going in and making an album and just getting your aggression out like they did with that album, it at least sends a message, and it is powerful, and it does something, and it's better than most of the other metal albums that sometimes just have no message and doesn't really do anything.
That's true. And it's good to have a message, man, whenever you're doing that music, because that's another thing that gets that people that extra little something, you know, when they're listening to something and then they catch it, and either when they're listening to the lyrics or when they're reading about it online, they're like, oh wow, I this actually hits me pretty good, and then they like it even more than they did going into it. So
and another thing that I noticed with maybe that album in particular is that they've been playing those songs more recently on the last tour, or like a few years ago, and I was watching some of it on YouTube, and there were people saying, you know, this is a really good song. You know,
yeah.
And I was thinking, exactly, that's exactly right. It is a really good song. It's just that people were thinking about, you know, other things and the production side of it, and they forgot about the fact that, hey, it's a solid song, and that's, you know, that's really what it comes down to. Because when you go live, you're not playing the record anymore. You're playing it again. It's live. And I mean, don't get me wrong. Some bands, or at least some artists, they basically just play the CD and dance to it, but or not the CD anymore. People don't use CDs anymore. That's just,
right?
I just keep thinking about the Ashley Simpson screw up on SNL where they play the wrong track for her voice.
That was great.
That was very awkward, but with a band like Metallica, that when you're there seeing a Metallica show, that's them playing. They're playing everything you hear is what they're doing.
Exactly.
And the fact that they can, you know, they're still doing it, they still sound powerful, is amazing considering all the damage they've done to themselves over the years. You know, and you know, I mean, it's awesome. I think it's great.
Yeah, I agree. So
Go ahead.
Okay. We're probably gonna maybe ask the same question, but what are you currently working on as far as trying to tour? Are you writing new music? Are you just practicing? Or
Because I was basically robbed a tour from me, I decided, because of COVID, I decided to start performing on Twitch. And it was actually something that I wanted to do. I wanted to do that for a long time. I mean, I was very familiar with Twitch, but really because it's really for video games, and that's arguably what most people go there for. I mean, there is the just chatting category, which does attract a certain perverted audience, but I discovered that there's actually a music section. And when I looked at it, it's like, there's people playing shows or sometimes there's actually whole bands doing it. And it's somebody with an acoustic guitar or maybe just, you know, some very simple thing. And I thought maybe I could do that. And it was definitely very complicated to figure out everything. Streaming is the whole thing of in and of itself.
Right.
It's not just about putting up a camera. I mean, there's a lot of settings and programs you have to learn. But it's definitely helped me because I do a show every Tuesday called Rock and Roll Tuesdays. I figured that Tuesdays are boring for most people.
Mm-hmm.
And I figured, you know, it's the most boring day of the week. Let's make it into something that at least, you know, rock and roll fans can look forward to. And so it's just me playing, well, mostly covers. I do play some songs off of Firestorm. I try to make sure that if people don't know who I am,
yes,
that at least they get a taste of what I normally do, because I normally play original music. I'm not a cover artist, even though I have made a lot of, that's the other thing I've been doing, is I've been making covers. And that's something I really started out doing right before the pandemic. And I just, I made a cover of Pink Floyd, Comfortably Numb.
Loved it. And,
you saw it. Awesome. And that was just some, that was just an idea I had, and I thought it would be fun. And then when the pandemic happened, I just, since I'm stuck at home, I figured why not make something that isn't an album, because when we go into the studio, we usually, you know, we're in the studio for maybe, you know, for a long time, and then this has to be mixed and mastered. And by the time you're done with it, it's been, you know, a couple of years or so. So I figured, you know, why not make a, you know, one cover at a time, make a video for it. And I can put it on social media, put it on YouTube. And it's not really a big official release. It's just something that I'm putting out for fun.
It is.
It gives me the ability to express myself and pay tribute to the artist that inspired me and kind of do the song in a different way. So a lot of them are kind of 80s inspired, because I love the 80s.
Yeah.
And I thought it'd be fun to make more like 80s versions of some of them. And others are more metal or, you know, whatever that makes sense to me. And it has helped a lot, because it keeps me busy. I always have something to do. That's really important. I think when you're going through a hard time, it's important to have something that keeps you from, you know, thinking about the bad stuff. You know, you're just always thinking, well, okay, I have to work on this, I have to work on that. And there's always something you can learn, and there's always something that you can improve on. And so it's just, it's been fun.
Hell yeah. And you know, you could start a podcast. No.
I've been thinking about it. I think podcasts are really, really fun. Maybe particularly when it's video and you can kind of see people and I think like this, like having guests on and things like that is a cool concept. Like when I'm doing the Twitch show, having people in the chat, you can kind of interact with people.
Yes.
And some of them are people that I didn't know before. Some of them are people I did know, but it's nice meeting people and actually developing fans, not just trying to maintain them during like a tough time. It's really nice to meet people. We're meeting a lot of people. We get a lot of people from Brazil and South America. They come in mainly because it's from the time zones are lining up nicely. So that's been really cool. Like meeting, you know, new people from there and people come back. That's the nice thing is that, it's not just like people stopping by for 2 minutes, but they actually come back every week and they suggest a lot of songs and, you know, we have a lot of fun with
that. That's cool. Hell yeah.
Try to make it kind of a community. I think that's important.
I agree.
Give people a place to be at some point, you know?
Yeah, it definitely
I'll definitely be COVID. I'll definitely be hopping on your next Twitch stream.
I will try. What time of day do you typically start your stream?
Rock and Roll Tuesdays is always at 7 p.m. Pacific.
Okay.
So that might be, you guys are 2 hours ahead of me or three. Yeah.
Two. I think two, and then Josh is three.
Josh is three. Okay, got it.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Well, yeah, I'll be able to watch.
So you can stop by and be like, play some death metal.
Yeah. I want to crash my work van, because I'll be listening while I'm driving home from work, because that's about when I get off work. So.
Oh, cool. Yeah, okay.
That'll be cool. Hell yeah, man.
The one question I had, since you're into 80s heavily. I can't help but imagine you should do some type of collaboration with Steel Panther.
I'm definitely open to it. I don't know those guys personally, but they're a fun bunch of guys. That's for sure. I mean, they're actually very talented too. I think they're very talented guys. They're kind of, it's like they're actually, I believe that they're all very, you know, trained musicians, and they're very good at what they do. But Steel Panther is kind of it's almost like a joke when you first see it. It's like, is this for real? Is it a parody? What is it?
I thought it was, honestly, at first too.
I think most people kind of, their first impression of them is like, are they serious? But it is good stuff. It is, it's great. I mean, it's 80s, and it's, they got some fun music videos, and then they're doing something that people want. And hey, I mean, it would be cool to do something with them if that was on the table, for sure.
Hell yeah.
All right, well, we'll tag Steel Panther, Justin Bieber. We'll let them all know. We're letting everyone know Rocky Kramer is about to just blow the world up. Yeah. Not literally.
not like that.
Yeah. Well, and that's another thing we were talking about earlier, is like a lot of the you know, original rock stars are, you know, retiring and, you know, kind of stepping out of the way, and they're making room for you, man. Sounds like they're.
I that's kind of how I think of it, is there's a lot of farewell tours and a lot of people getting ready to stop. So I want to be there when they stop, because you know, they can't be replaced with nothing. They have to be replaced with someone else. And I would love to be that one, you know, that
it's perfect.
You know, it's a new generation of rock and roll.
Yes. And that's exactly what, like whenever I listened to Firestorm, I totally got all the inspirations that, you know, that came from the original rock stars. It's there. So you definitely have it. Like, it's definitely there. But yeah, I'm excited, man. And we're going to make sure that when we wrap up here in just a second, we're going to make sure we get all of your information, everything you want us to put in our descriptions for all, like, because this podcast goes to like every platform. We want the description to have your Twitch channel, your YouTube channel, your website,
anything you want.
Anything you want. Yes.
My OnlyFans.
Yeah. He's got one of those too.
I'm signing up. It better be some like scandalous 80s like poses with like your guitar and stuff.
Oh yeah, there you go. There you go.
So is there absolutely anything that you want to say to our listeners, to the people that will listen? Any message you want to convey? Anything?
Nothing special, just you know, just hang in there, you know. You know, I know that a lot of people are maybe not having the best time of their lives right now, but it's gonna get better. It's gonna work out. We're gonna be fine.
What you need to do is, and this is to the listeners, if you're having a hard time, what you need to do is find you a tennis instructor and tell them what your dreams are, because they'll hook you up with the next person in your, you know, to get you on that path. Right? Is that
exactly?
go to LA. Go to LA, man. And don't sleep on the tennis instructors. I said that correctly. Okay.
Okay. I said that correctly.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, man, it's been awesome having you on, man. Seriously. Anytime you ever want to come back and shoot the shit with us, we're down anytime.
Thank you guys. So you guys have been great. I've had a very enjoyable time.
Yes. Good. I like that, man. So we are hopefully, you know, we'll stay in touch with you as much as we possibly can. We're not going to stalk you yet. Period. But yeah, man, it's been so awesome having you, and I hope you have a great rest of your evening, and we look forward to following you, man, because it's going to be cool.
Yeah, you too, guys. It's been a pleasure.
Hell yeah.
That's Rocky Kramer, everybody.
Woo!
Rock on.
Rock on, for sure.